What do diamonds, bubbles in your beer, trees, and graphene all have in common? They are all mostly made of carbon. And coincidentally, carbon in the form of carbon dioxide is something that we have way too much of in the atmosphere at the moment. Can we solve our carbon problem and get something useful from it at the same time? Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. I've already talked about carbon capture and storage on this channel before, and today I want to talk about another related acronym, CCU, where the U stands for utilisation. So this is the idea that you can take carbon dioxide and make things, useful things, ranging from fuel to diamonds. So that sounds great, but if you take a look at the actually existing operational carbon capture facilities, like in the Global CCS Institute's facilities database, you'll see that nearly all of the world's current carbon capture is used for enhanced oil recovery. So that's where they inject CO2 into oil reservoirs to help push out the last little bit of oil that they would otherwise not have been able to reach. So much of the CO2 does stay underground, but of course more CO2 is released when the extra oil is burned, so it's not exactly a carbon neutral exercise. In the net zero future that most countries have by now signed up to, we're going to want to have ways to store CO2 without releasing more CO2 in the process. So we're going to need ways to do that. The perfect carbon dioxide users would be economic, so either very cheap to produce, or maybe they're making something that has a really high value. They should be scalable because we're going to need to remove gigatons, that's billions of tons of CO2 from the atmosphere each year. And finally, a perfect CO2 use would keep that carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere permanently. Recently, I've seen heaps of different carbon-using technologies in the news. People are making all kinds of things from CO2 now, from diamonds to alcohol to protein shakes. And of course, Elon Musk's foundation has the X Prize, which is awarding $100 million for solutions that can pull carbon dioxide directly from the atmosphere or oceans and sequester it durably and sustainably. So all eyes are on carbon utilization now, but with so many options out there, it's kind of hard to tell which of these are going to be able to make a real difference. So I got in touch with Dr. Jessica Allen, who's a chemical engineer and senior lecturer at the University of Newcastle. Jess has been researching and developing uses for CO2 for over a decade. So I'm going to ask her to explain the different ways that we can use CO2 for things other than enhanced oil recovery. We're going to find out how these carbon-using processes actually work, what their advantages and challenges are, and whether there's any potential to solve those challenges. And we'll be running through a lot of different technologies. So I'll put bookmarks in the description if you want to jump straight to a specific technology. We're going to start with the trendy CO2 uses that I've seen covered a lot in the news and on YouTube recently. So these include protein, carbon nanofibers, fish food, alcohol, carbonated beverages, diamonds, and probably even more than those, because carbon is such a versatile atom. So I've always been pretty skeptical of these CO2 using climate solutions because, as I mentioned before, we'll eventually need to remove gigatons of CO2 from the atmosphere each year. That's billions of tons. And, well, there's a reason why we use carats to measure the weight of diamonds and not gigatons. Can these kinds of uses ever remove a meaningful amount of carbon from the atmosphere? Or is the entire point of them just to make their inventors and investors feel smug and look trendy?
Yeah, I think you're right. The trendiness of them is questionable and the scale that we need it. So even if it's not going to be used to offset the amount of emissions we currently have, we do want to be using it on a significant scale. So you want something that's going to be making a product that's going to be used on a significant scale. Beer maybe is used on a significant scale, but carbonation. So they use carbon dioxide in soft drinks, all sorts of areas where you have carbonated beverages, but it's released as soon as you open it up. Carbon dioxide is gone again. So it's not really a storage.
It doesn't sound like we're going to be digging ourselves out of the climate crisis by making gigatons of diamonds from captured CO2, unfortunately. And there are some other uses of CO2 that are a bit more useful, like graphene or other carbon-based materials that are used in electronics and other industries. And they currently have a lot of emissions in their supply chains. So using CO2 to make those products instead of using processes that emit CO2 would help those industries become carbon neutral even as they expand. If we imagine our net zero future, I guess that every company and every industry is going to have to be carbon neutral. So for those industries, those options will be important. But when people talk about carbon utilization, they're usually talking about its potential to kind of like undo some of the CO2 we've already emitted into the atmosphere. And as I keep on mentioning, that means gigatons of removal. We are simply never going to need that much graphene or graphite or other similar materials. So now I want to talk about the uses for carbon that have the potential to scale to a useful amount. And one that I hear a lot about is fuels made from CO2. So this could be really helpful for applications that are hard to electrify. What can Jess tell us about using carbon dioxide to make synthetic fuels?
Probably the biggest opportunity in terms of the need will be the biggest for fuels and for syngas fuels. So carbon dioxide, so CO2, can be reduced to carbon monoxide, CO. So that is essentially a fuel. It's most useful when it's combined with other types of gases with calorific value like hydrogen or methane. So you can have sort of a mixture of gases, and that's when they call it a syngas. So it's a synthesis gas, a mixture of different gas components. Like with an electrolysis for water to make hydrogen and oxygen, you can do a combined electrolyzer that reduces carbon dioxide and water to make carbon monoxide and hydrogen. So it makes this sort of synthesis gas in that electrochemical technology. And then that gas can be used in a number of different applications. I guess the caveat is where once you burn it again, you make CO2 again. If it's not released at a point source where you can capture the CO2 and reuse it, then it is going to be just released into the atmosphere. But it's a way of the way people sometimes talk about it is a way of sort of reducing emission intensity. So it gives it a loop where it's reused one more time. The future looking for that technology would be to use direct air capture to make concentrated carbon dioxide and then turn that into a fuel, which can then be released and then recaptured.
Yeah,
it's energy intensive. Yeah. So to get that synthesis fuel, that syngas fuel, it's taking a lot of energy. So the question is, where are you going to use the syngas fuel and what for? It might just be better off to use electricity. And that's why we talk a lot about electrification and technology and industry electrification, trying to make everything possible electric so that it can just directly run off renewables.
Synthetic fuels will definitely be helpful, but if they're actually going to be carbon neutral, that means we're going to need to recapture the CO2 back out of the air, which is not exactly easy. Next, I want to move on to CO2 uses that allow permanent storage. And one option is to produce methanol, which is already used to make a lot of durable products like plastic.
Methanol is another sort of intermediate chemical that can be made from CO2 and hydrogen. And we make methanol already around the world from CO2 and hydrogen, but the CO2 and the CO, sorry, it's got a number of steps, will come from natural gas reforming and coal gas gasification.
Okay.
So there's areas there for replacement of what's already been done in industry with CO2 that's captured instead. But you can take methanol and upgrade it and process it. Usually you have to add more hydrogen and a few things along the way to make it into the stable plastic. But that is a way to have a stable compound at the end, because often when you're making fuels and jet fuels, so aviation fuels, they're again combusted and you again release the CO2. So if you were going to stabilize it, the plastics are a way to create a stable product and to offset what's already been made with fossil fuels.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, obviously people are rightly concerned about the amount of plastic that we use anyway. So maybe it's not like a very catchy kind of sales pitch for this.
Yeah. Make plastic. It'll last forever. Basically anything that we do is like you just need so much energy, so much electricity. And if we're going to make it renewable, it's renewable electricity. So it's everything is going to need energy. So we need a lot of zero emission energy to do any of this.
I feel like with methanol, we've got closer to a scalable and permanent use for CO2, but I think that most people would probably prefer that plastics actually didn't stick around permanently. So let's then move on to the couple of technologies that I'm most excited about: mineral carbonation and then biochar.
Mineral carbonation takes basically minerals that we've dug out of the ground and separated out to make oxide-rich materials, and you can also do it promisingly from things like fly ash and other waste streams from, you know, heritage fossil fuel generation. So using that is preferable rather than digging up the raw materials. Basically, you end up with an oxide-rich stream, and then with enough, again, energy, it needs heat, and you need to introduce the carbon dioxide into that, and it will turn into a carbonate. So the oxide plus the carbon dioxide makes CO3 and whatever metal is attached to it. Usually it's calcium, or they've also using a number of different types of fly ash that have different compounds. So what you end up with is that carbonated material. So it's a stable, potentially long-term storage of carbon dioxide. The value of that is still sort of trying to be realized, because with that carbonation process, when they're just taking things from the ground, it can't just be directly used in concrete at the moment. So the way that they do it is they make it into other types of building materials and trying to offset the use of concrete and other things within building materials using those carbonates.
This is a technology that I definitely plan to keep a close eye on as it develops, and I'll hopefully be able to do a project tour sometime this year. Now let's move on to the final carbon using technology on our list, biochar.
Let's talk a little bit about pyrolysis first, slow pyrolysis. So the idea is, so coal is basically biomass that's had all of its volatile, so the oxygen and the hydrogen component has been slowly released, and the carbon had been concentrated over time into this highly carbonaceous material. When you start off with biomass and you want to make it into carbon, basically you need to heat it, but you don't want oxygen to be present. If you heat it with oxygen there, it's just going to burn. It's going to turn into carbon dioxide. But if you heat it without air or without any oxygen present, what happens is that it starts to decompose thermally. So if you heat it nice and slowly, it basically will soften and form this oil, and then it will reform into a solid char material. So the carbon becomes concentrated, the volatiles are released, which if there's not any oxygen present, you'll make things like a syngas. Essentially, it'll be carbon monoxide, hydrogen, methane. So that is a combustible mixture that is released. So that syngas can go off and be used to make electricity, and it can also be used to heat the pyrolysis reactor, because that takes temperature to heat that up. And what you're left with is the stable carbon component, and that is the biochar. So you make electricity and you also make char as the material. Now, the carbon component of this is, so if you're burning your syngas, you're releasing CO2, right? So it ends up having a release. But because you're stabilizing a portion of that carbon as a carbon-rich char, it can, if it's engineered properly, end up being a carbon negative process. Because biomass is generally thought to be neutral, so you capture the carbon dioxide into the biomass, you burn it, you release the CO2. It's just that short-term carbon cycle. Of course, you've got to collect the biomass and transport the biomass, so it doesn't always end up being exactly neutral. But if you do it in a way that you're offsetting some of that by capturing and storing some of the carbon in a carbon-rich material, it can be carbon negative.
Okay.
People get very excited about biochar because it's this carbon-rich material that can be added into soils, and it increases the carbon components in the soil. So carbon-rich soils have increased crop growth and enhanced outcomes for agriculture.
There is a whole lot more to the pyrolysis / biochar story than what I could fit into this broad video on a lot of different carbon uses. And I know that a lot of you guys are really excited about this technology, so I want to do a whole video just on that later in the year and show the slow pyrolysis process, plus talk more about what we can do with it and some of the challenges. So please leave comments for what you'd like to see in that video. Let's pull it all together now. I'm interested in how Jess sees these technologies fitting into the energy transition as a whole. Is Jess feeling optimistic about how we're progressing?
I think that there is momentum building now globally. A lot of interest in hydrogen and electrification and different types of renewables and storage and And there's momentum there, and industry as well is starting to see some movement in technology and development of different types of processes that complement. So if we can do those ones quickly and in the background be working on rolling out these technologies and doing things where it makes sense, like making biochar and having carbon negative technologies as much as possible, we can get there. But really, I think in the end, we need carbon capture and storage to work. We need it to work. It has to work. The only thing that's going to be able to meet that scale is probably, from what everything I've seen, is going to be storage.
Thanks for a great conversation, Jess. I really loved how she put everything in context, considering the scale of the problem and what each technology's potential contribution will be. Carbon utilization could reduce emissions intensity in the case of synthetic fuels. It could help to decarbonize hard-to-abate sectors like building materials, and it could potentially create negative emissions through products like biochar. But taken all together, these are still not going to add up to the gigatons of CO2 that we're going to need to capture and store each year. For that, we'll need to be storing a lot of carbon underground. And coincidentally, actually not a coincidence, I have another expert lined up to interview on CO2 storage. So watch out for that video in a couple of months. And then there is the fact that Jess raised a few times that capturing and processing CO2 into products uses a lot of energy. And that energy really needs to come from renewable sources. Otherwise, we're just taking like two steps forward, one step back, and the size of our carbon removal problem is just going to grow and grow. Thanks again to Jess for this very informative conversation. The full conversation was a lot longer and more detailed on most of these topics. I actually make the full interviews available to the Engineering with Rosie Patreon team. So if you're interested to join me and other energy nerds like me to help steer the future direction of the channel, then you can join us at this link. I'll see you in the next video.